You know we're gonna be late, right?
We have like 5 minutes.
And 2 minutes.
Oh gosh, they're going.
And the worst part is we're not even like dressed for this.
That's okay, we'll get dressed for this soon.
Happy Monday night. Welcome back to Late Night Marywood, everyone.
Yes, welcome. We are excited that you're tuning in.
I think it's safe to say that spring is officially here, especially with that 80 degree weather today. Oh, loved it. Maybe my ode to Mother Nature from a couple weeks ago helped a little bit. Fingers crossed.
Yeah, I think so. Doesn't this weather make you want to sing all the time?
Of course it does. It reminds me of that movie Enchanted way back when Amy Adams ran through the park and everyone just stares at her because she's not from their world and she's singing weirdly.
That's such a good movie. I can definitely see you running through the Learning Commons doing that.
Back at the LC, look, there's a book and Dylan's here. Dylan's here, read this book. Dylan's here, give this book a chance. Dylan's here, why won't you read with me?
Ah, reliving my childhood more and more every day with Disney.
Disney will never fail you to do that.
Oh, most definitely not, especially because they're revamping my childhood with all the live-action Disney movies coming out. I'm so excited.
You must have been pretty excited when Beauty and the Beast just came out.
Oh, definitely. I was indeed, because Belle is my favorite Disney princess, and she really represents the whole embracing inner beauty, which I think is important.
Yeah, I agree. I'm really happy that Disney is doing that, because not only are today's children not so sure about the tales and everything for Disney, they're getting the chance to see it coming live action with live actors rather than just animated.
Mm-hmm, definitely.
And last week we talked about national holidays and we unfortunately just missed National Princess Day.
We did. National Princess Day was March 3rd actually, but that's okay, Anne, because you're a princess every day. But what's your favorite Disney princess? You know mine's Belle.
Yes, yours is Belle. I think mine is Ariel because I've always wanted to swim. I remember when I was younger, probably like maybe 11 or so, my mom would give me the chore of cleaning my room. And of course, no child wants to clean their room, I guess.
Maybe we should do like a package underwater next time and like play it on the show. We should just have a whole show underwater.
And we could use the green screen. Yeah. That'd be pretty awesome.
Maybe something coming up in the next couple shows.
So with cleaning my room, I would put a towel around my legs and like get on the floor and like clean up some of my toys.
Mulan is another good Disney movie.
Oh, yeah.
That's one of them that they're making a live action.
And I heard the actors for Mulan are actually going to be Asian, which is great because what other way to show the actors than the actual ones who live there?
It's always great. I mean, I love Disney and, you know, I think I want them to do Rapunzel, so Tangled, of course. I want them to do a live action with that. I think that's pretty cool. And then what
about maybe Sleeping Beauty?
Sleeping Beauty. They kind of did
Not with Cinderella. I think there's enough Cinderella.
Cinderella's old. They kind of done that already a couple times.
This movie's not really too popular, but do you know Brave? I love that movie with her hair.
I think because like, if you think about it, with live action movies, especially with Disney World being so popular, you kind of actually bring those characters more so to life than them just being animated, which I think is pretty cool. I'm hoping, fingers crossed, everyone, and you know, if the parents are listening, let's hope their fingers are really crossed. I hope I get to go down to Florida soon. I had a bunch of friends go down during spring break, and they came back with all like their Disney autographs and stuff.
Nice.
And Marywood offers like a Disney internship down there, which I think is really cool.
I would love to get me a pair of Minnie Mouse ears. That'd be pretty awesome.
Let's be princesses when we go down there.
We're gonna take a short break, but we're gonna be right back right here on Late Night Marywood.
You know what, guys? There's a lot of tree branches and dry brush over here. We should probably move the bonfire over there.
Mm-hmm. I'm guessing Smokey liked that idea.
You've messed up your son's haircut.
Mom?
Do you A, try to fix it?
Like it never happened.
B, work with what you got? Or C, show solidarity?
Thank you, babe.
As a parent, there are no perfect answers. But you don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care will love you just the same.
There are 16 million children struggling with hunger in America. That's 1 in 5 daughters, sons, neighbors, and classmates who don't know where their next meal is coming from. Yet billions of pounds of good food go to waste every year. It's time we do something about it. Feeding America is a nationwide network of food banks that helps provide meals to millions of kids and families in need. Visit feedingamerica.org to help them feed even more. Together, we can solve hunger. Together, we're feeding America.
Welcome back. Fun fact about Rachel and I was her summer orientation leader.
It was a lot of fun having you be my leader, and because now you're a mentor for me in the department. But I did realize something I didn't ask you during orientation was how the whole study room and the LC kind of thingy works there.
Yeah, so in the Learning Commons, we have a lot of study rooms, and there's a way to reserve those, so when it comes down to our midterms or any time where we definitely need the study rooms for groups or individual, that you have to do reservations. And it definitely is a struggle when we're all trying to fight for the study rooms.
Really? I can't picture that.
Well, let me show you.
Ma'am, get your hand off that doorknob.
This is my
your
room.
Door?
Well, this is my study room.
No, listen, this is Dylan and
Brett. Find another one. This one's
they
fine.
Had it registered.
I don't think so.
Wait.
Excuse me. Hi.
Rachel, what are you doing?
You're a freshman. We have 4 dibs on this room.
What do you mean what I'm doing? I'm taking the study room and I'm studying for my exams.
This is not fair. We have a lot of work to do.
Yeah, it's,
more work than you do.
Like, we're getting ready for you.
We need just all the
graduation
sandwiches
and
you're
she's
gonna have
like,
to do.
I don't care. No one was in here, so when you guys are gonna pick her, I'm not. I'm just gonna study.
Okay, and the difference is something about the. What are you doing? Can I help you, please? You need to scoot down. Learn how to write with your right hand, like everybody
how
else.
How about you stop being obnoxious and just move?
I was here first.
No, I wasn't. You just saw I entered this room
I was
first.
Here first.
I don't care.
I have
I'm
more
just
work. I have more work to you.
Shut up.
What are you doing?
Don't let
right,
me
the
know.
Right way, people.
This is so passive aggressive. Oh my gosh.
I have one pen.
Yeah, okay, I got you now. So basically, just give up now, because whether you reserve one or not, there's just not enough spaces.
Exactly.
Glad to know. I also finally understand the struggles with registration, especially since I have to register last because of freshman status.
It's really hard when it crashes because we're all on there at midnight trying to register our classes for next semester, and we're all fighting really hard for that last spot.
Or your advisor just doesn't release you.
Don't forget the possible chance of you forgetting to pay your parking ticket.
All the classic first world problems in college.
Need to go. Like, I need to get into these classes.
I gotta make sure I have all of them filled in.
I think okay. I'm missing one.
Do you have to make sure you have history and all that?
I have history. Oh my god, Spanish is only down to one seat
you
left.
You have one seat left?
I have one seat left. I need
oh
to get into this
press
class. Okay, go. Oh, it's midnight. Go.
Okay. Spinning death.
Okay.
Loading.
Okay, wait, it's going. It's now 12:02 and I can't get anything done.
Well, last night was freshman registration. Did you make it into all your classes?
Luckily, yes, but I was really stressing because all of my classes only had like 1 and 2 seats left in the sections that I needed. So.
Well, now that registration is over, we're in the home stretch, which finally means final projects. I'm sure most students out there have a lot of group projects to finish, which basically means really focusing before finals.
In our department, we do group projects a lot differently. We rent out equipment to film video projects, and there is a lot of students and not as many cameras, so we all really rush to rent things out as soon as possible.
We really fight for the death for the equipment.
Hey, I need equipment.
I'm sorry, but there's only one camera left.
No, I need the camera, so.
I need equipment too.
I have a project.
I have my senior sim project.
You're not even a senior.
Yes, I am.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
I still need it. 3 projects, 4 interviews. Gosh.
Please, do you have more than one?
Rock, paper, scissors.
Rock, paper, scissors.
Rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Fighting to death with rock, paper, scissors, that is. And it's always more efficient than really fighting to the death, so.
We hope that the end of your semester struggles aren't as bad as ours.
I think Scranton is having a little bit of a semester struggle with all the water breakage.
Yeah, I had, so the main water broke.
About Friday or Saturday?
Yeah, I think
about
Saturday.
This weekend.
I got out of work, and after work I usually like to shower and then start my work and get ready for the rest of the weekend. And my shower in the dorm was not working, so that wasn't major setback.
Yeah, everyone should really be aware. Luckily, people are really communicating with us, which is always great for students and staff to really just get going and, you know, knowing that the little C might not be open at this time, or NAS is closing, or it's staying open, luckily for all of us. And just, it's always nice to have that communication, because it is hard when, you know, you have an expectation and then it doesn't work out the way
yeah,
you want it to.
I was really happy that they were giving us updates on emails about when the water may be back.
Yeah.
So that's pretty good. Now we have water back. So
and they're still giving us
good.
Updates. So
oh, yeah.
I feel like we got about, what, like 3 emails today giving us updates, which is always great. So we really appreciate it, Marywood. So
especially at the end
great.
Of our semester, we got all this work to do. We want to know what's
yeah.
up.
So grab a cup of coffee at Late Night from NAS tonight. So, and we got more right after this break, so stay tuned.
There are 16 million children struggling with hunger in America. That's 1 in 5 daughters, sons, neighbors, and classmates who don't know where their next meal is coming from. Yet billions of pounds of good food go to waste every year. It's time we do something about it. Feeding America is a nationwide network of food banks that helps provide meals to millions of kids and families in need. Visit feedingamerica.org to help them feed even more. Together, we can solve hunger. Together, we're feeding America.
This is the story of a boy who is very sensitive to lights and sounds. So he built secret hiding places where nothing could get in. The boy didn't like looking people in the eye. It made him feel uncomfortable. One day, he found out he had something called autism. His family got him help, and slowly, he learned how to live with it better.
Early intervention can make a lifetime of difference. Learn the signs at autismspeaks.org.
They said I have troll teeth.
That my voice sounded like a possessed baby doll.
That no one would ever love someone as stupid as me.
That I was fat, ugly.
Disgusting.
The effect of bullying is potent.
We will no longer be the silent majority.
Now, when you see online bullying, there's something you can do about it.
We're gonna take action with the eye.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness, and so are you.
So who's gonna do what?
I'll pack the dead batteries.
Great.
I'll only put what I don't need into a duffel bag.
Perfect, that's totally unhelpful.
No problem.
Meanwhile, I will try to comfort everyone by speaking in a calm voice.
And who is going to handle supplies?
I can forget to do a list for us.
Thanks, pal.
We couldn't be any less prepared. I'm proud of you guys.
Talk to your kids about who to call, where to meet, what to pack. Visit ready.gov/kids for tips and information.
Tonight's first guest is an award-winning filmmaker. He studied at New York University, producing films which premiered at the International Film Festivals. In addition to producing film, he has also produced content for National Cable Television Network and is a member of the National Academy of Television Arts and Sciences, as well as the American Associate of Political Consultants. So please welcome 2-time Polly Award winner, Joe Van Wee. Thank you so much for coming. We really appreciate it. You have a lot of experience, and we're really excited to kind of like talk to you about that.
Sure.
So can you just start by kind of just telling us how you kind of made your way into the industry? What made you really want to do filmmaking?
I was a heavy drinker, and I didn't like working in the day. So the films I enjoyed were always made at night. But pretty much a lot of how I got started was the acting, stand-up. And then from that point on, I started working behind the camera in a couple episodes of Law & Order, PA, and then after a while I realized it wouldn't take long to shoot a short, and then started producing features from there.
So you went to NYU and you spent about a decade in New York City. Can you tell us a little bit about what that was like as a filmmaker and a producer?
Sure. I was expelled from NYU. I was a philosophy major. I wasn't studying film. I learned on set. So learning how to make film in New York, you kind of learn the formalities of crew life, and it gets pretty small on that island after a while. It's the same ADs, same PAs, grips, then you get into electrical and all that stuff. So you start to meet people, and you could always pick up gigs that way. Eventually, I just moved back home and started a film company here. And the first film I jumped on board to produce was we shot in the Dominican Republic. And that was in Toronto Film Festival in 2009, honorable mention, La Soga. It's on Netflix now. So that was the first film I really cut my teeth on producing. And then I did a couple shorts, documentaries. And then Forged would be the film that I brought back to Scranton. So primarily, most of my films were made from here. I moved back home by that time.
And you do a lot of political ads and educational mm-hmm. ads. So what's that kind of like, doing different genres of advertisements and kind of making them into promotional videos?
50% fun, 50% boring. So a lot of times it depends on the client. If you like them, do you want to advertise for them? Other times it just keeps the lights on so we get to our next film. But politics is fun. I've always had that's my second interest besides film. And so that's always fun to get out there. I mean, the paradigm has changed so much, especially with media and how it's delivered. It's still exciting.
For our audience who may not be so familiar with your films, what are some of the themes and the messages in your films?
They're dark, independent films, usually the bounds of forgiveness, redemption, kind of nihilistic tones over them. Forge is a pretty dark movie. That won the HBO International Latino Film Festival. That had a great premiere. We premiered that in 27 cities theatrically. And then we had a good run on Showtime and a few others, but most of the themes are dark.
Do you have any like specific inspirations to kind of producing and kind of picking location?
Yeah, pretty much soup to nuts. Most of the projects, because they're independent, I'm pretty much as the EP or part of the creative team, I would be able to have influence over all that. Okay.
And you also have your own company, JWV Inc.
JWV Inc. is an ad agency, and Revere Pictures is our film company. So the advertising isn't as fun as, you know, making a film, but making films is really hard, especially to recoup now. There's so many venues for streaming. They're not all lucrative. So it's tough out there for independent filmmakers right now.
Right. And I have to ask, because we were talking about your company a little bit, I saw in like your staff profile that you have two dogs featured on there. Can you tell us a little bit about them?
I got a pug, Napoleon, he's four, and then Brando is the logo of JVW. He's an old dog, he's 10 years old, Boston Aww. Terrier, and then I have a German Shepherd.
Wow.
There's dogs all over my office, a madhouse.
Yeah. So what's like your day-to-day life kind of between film and doing the advertisement business? Can you just walk us through your day in the office?
In the office, I roll in around 10. I'm not a morning person by any means. So I go in there. I'm usually a distraction to most of the staff I have. I usually tell a bunch of jokes, then people want me to leave them alone. And then when everyone leaves at the end of the day, I actually do my work. So I'll probably leave the office around 9, 10 o'clock sometimes.
So what are some things that you're currently working on?
Right now we have a batch of regional ads from here out to Erie, politics, House rep races, and then energy companies. There's a windmill project we're doing out in Missouri right now, mm-hmm. and it's just persuasive marketing to show clean energy for the school district that might build on their property windmills. For one of our clients.
Mm-hmm. So I know you said that a lot, you do love doing like political ads and stuff like mm-hmm. that. So kind of with the 2016 election, has that kind of boosted the way you advertise lately?
No, it makes you question every way you advertise. Does the truth even matter at all? If someone doesn't have enough money to advertise that it wasn't. The paradigm of politics has changed so much, it's almost frightening of where it's going. Nothing's really based in reality. So things that were, unethical to do 10 years ago are, I mean, everything's in play now. It's just a strange approach. Things you might scoff at, just slimy attack ads on Facebook that aren't even close to being the truth, right, are now effective.
Right. And you're also part of the National Academy for Television and Science. Mm-hmm. So how did you kind of get part of that organization?
Paying them. But most of the time it's just if you're active and you want to submit every year all of your daytime television shows you might have produced, or if you ads or any kind of content that you created for television, you'd like to submit it each year for the crew and the staff that worked on there, worked hard on it, so and compete to have an Emmy.
That's awesome. And so you've also won a couple awards. Can you tell us a little bit about them?
Yeah. We won some awards for La Soga at Toronto. We also won the Santo Domingo Best Picture with La Soga Film Festival. HBO International Latino for Forged. We were in the LA Film Festival for Forged. We got really good reviews in New York Times and Variety at a great premiere. Forged probably got the most accolades. And then the rest of the awards, the Polies, are usually political awards, peer-reviewed. Political.
Sounds like you've really like scattered across the map there. Where do you think is probably your favorite location for working?
My house on the couch with Doritos.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
And you've traveled before to do film shoots.
Sure.
And can you tell us a little bit about, before you said the Dominican Republic, can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. It's difficult if you're not from there to shoot there. So half of our crew, I'd say 70% of our crew on that film was from the Dominican Republic, which has a flourishing film industry and television. They make all their own content. So we had the resource of that and rentals, but you run into all these problems with the union, and then we had a lot of animals in the film. That was difficult because it was non-union, no PETA representation there. Will this block our distribution? So depending on where you're shooting, I mean, a whole host of problems can arise that make the film far more difficult. And you're trying to save money, so the problems usually cost money on set.
Wow, a lot of fun.
Have you ever filmed anywhere other than the Dominican Republic?
Sure.
Internationally?
No, not in any narrative, no. Mm-hmm. No, the Dominican Republic, most of our ads are U.S.-based, but other than that, no.
That's great.
Would love to, as long as it's not snowing.
Right, no snow is always good.
No more snow.
Yeah, I don't need the script, just tell me where it is. If it's sunny, I'll take the job.
Right, we are going to take a short break, but we'll be right back, so stay tuned.
So who's going to do what?
I'll pack the dead batteries.
Great.
I'll only put what I don't need into a duffel bag.
Perfect. That's totally unhelpful.
No problem.
Meanwhile, I will try to comfort everyone by speaking in a calm voice.
And who is going to handle supplies?
I can forget to do a list for us.
Thanks, pal.
We couldn't be any less prepared. I'm proud of you guys.
Talk to your kids about who to call, where to meet, what to pack. Visit ready.gov/kids for tips and information.
Alvin and the Chipmunks want to remind you, bacteria can hide in food and make you ill.
Wow.
But you can keep bacteria from ruining your day with four simple steps. Clean.
I'm waiting for the rim cycle.
Separate. Cook.
Fire in the hole.
And chill.
We chipmunks are notoriously tidy.
Check your steps. The road trip to food safety starts at foodsafety.gov.
There's one thing you can never have sex without.
It's not something you buy.
Or something you take.
In fact, there's only one way to get it.
It has to be given to you, freely.
It's consent.
Because sex without it isn't sex.
It's rape. Consent.
If you don't get it, you don't get it. It's on us to stop sexual assault.
Learn how and take the pledge at itsonus.org.
Right, mi cariño. So like I said, everything I learned about cooking, I learned from grandma's empanadas. Shall we go again?
Yep.
Mix the beef with the onions with the peppers with the paprika, the garlic with the oregano with the cumin. Got it?
Got it.
Throw on the olives, stir, season, stir again, pour out the flour, roll out the dough, make a circle, drop in a fistful of filling, fold over, press down, and ta-da!
Most parenting is hard to do in just 2 minutes. But 2 minutes twice a day making sure they brush is easier, and it could help save them from a lifetime of tooth pain.
You think getting dumped by text is harsh? Try getting dumped by tennis ball. My ex-owner drove me out to the woods, yelled fetch, and by the time I brought the ball back, he was gone. Yeah, I was pissed. But the folks at the shelter helped me let go of my anger. I learned coping skills, like taking it to the hole. Boom! Now I'm ready to fetch again. But how about I throw and you run and get it?
Todd's a great guy. I mean, look at him. What a sweetheart. Attaboy. Wait, Todd, what are you doing? How totally selfish and un-Todd-like of you. Come on, Todd. Come on, man.
Welcome back. Joined with us now is filmmaker and producer Joe Van Wee. So you are a filmmaker and you spent time in New York City and scattered around the U.S. Could you tell us about your survival tip for producing films, especially that long process? You have scripts, you have editing, so much goes into a film. What is your survival kit for doing it all?
Oof. I don't know how to sum that up. Never lie to your money and ignore your crew. Right. Or the last few things you can't pay for.
Right.
So Forged is one of very popular movies here based in Scranton. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Forged starred Manny Perez and Margot Martindale. And it was about a father and son relationship. A father went to jail for manslaughter. He shot his wife drunk in some dispute. And the son, at the time, ends up in foster homes. And his plan at 16, when his dad's released, he's going to kill him. And he ran away from this foster home to be there to kill his father. And the same time before he kills him, he starts to get to know him. And then we see where the story goes from there. What's worth forgiving and how much deserves forgiveness. So especially from an adolescent mind.
What was it like filming directly here in Scranton?
Really hard. A lot of easy things because of how helpful everyone was and locations. And with the city of Scranton, Wilkes-Barre, all the locations we had really became a character in itself in the film because they were so dynamic. We got the Lackawanna County Prison, hospitals, the Scranton Lace Factory, and it made the film look really great. Other than that, the difficulty was the weather. It was the coldest winter on record for like 50 years.
Wow.
And a lot of our shots were exteriors.
And what do you think was your favorite part about, again, the production for the whole film?
My favorite part? You know, I always like to say when it's complete and you're shopping it around, but that's not the truth. After we wrap, the mindless hustle of a 14-hour day for 6 days a week, and then when it's over, you're exhausted and you miss it. So shooting's my favorite.
Right. So we do like to connect things back to our Marywood students, especially with us in the comm department. Do you have any advice for our peers or other students who might not even be in this department if they want to get into filmmaking or producing?
I don't know. My advice, it would just be mine. I mean, find out everything you don't want to do. Get some experience, especially if you want to tell stories. You got to go find out some stories. Go live an interesting life. Just never let anything get in the way of living an interesting life. That would be my advice.
Well, thank you for talking to us. We look forward to seeing and watching some more of your future projects. Thank you again for coming on the show, and we'll be right back after this.
Todd's a great guy. I mean, look at him. What a sweetheart. Attaboy. Wait, Todd, what are you doing? How totally selfish and un-Todd-like of you. Come on, Todd. Come on, man.
You're doing great. We're gonna try this again, okay?
Okay.
Wheels, pedals, handlebar, brakes. Sit up straight, keep your weight in the center, keep your eyes on the road, hands on the grips, button the seat. If we feel ourselves falling, what do?
Just keep pedaling.
Good girl. Now remember, it's all about balance and steering. Steer with your hands, steer with your body. Steer into the corners and you stay out of trouble. And the bell's your buddy, so go ahead and ding that. All right, ready? Here we go. Pedal, honey, pedal. There you go, you're a bike rider.
Most parenting is hard to do in just 2 minutes. But 2 minutes twice a day making sure they brush is easier, and it could help save them from a lifetime of tooth pain.
You know what, guys? There's a lot of tree branches and dry brush over here. We should probably move the bonfire over there.
I'm guessing Smokey liked that idea.
Some of you may know tonight's musical guest. She's a singer-songwriter from right here in Scranton. She's played in the Scranton Fringe Festival and is and played at the Leonard Theater in downtown Scranton. Additionally, she has just released her own first EP, Alive, on iTunes back in March, and she has been listed in the top EP albums. Please welcome Mollie Edsell. So thank you for joining us. So how are you feeling tonight?
Feeling great. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for coming on. We really appreciate it. So you are still in high school. You're a senior.
Yes.
And you are doing this awesome project of releasing your album. So can you just tell us a little bit about yourself and kind of how you got involved with music?
Yeah, sure. Well, this is the first musical project I've ever been a part of. My stepdad and I got in touch with Jamie Tate from the Ruckus Room in Nashville. And he's an Grammy award-winning producer in Nashville. So it was amazing to hear from him. And we headed down to Nashville, and the rest is history.
So have you always been singing and, you know, playing the guitar?
Yeah, ever since I was about 9 years old, you know, my parents would be playing Grateful Dead records and, you know, Bee Gees music, and it would just really resonated with me very well. So ever since then, I've been playing guitar, listening to music, and just, it's been an obsession.
So what are some of your influences or idols as a musician?
Yeah, definitely Grateful Dead. I was basically raised on that. The Beatles, 80s pop influences too, definitely for my mom. Yeah.
Shout out to your mom.
Hi, Mom.
Yeah, so you are 17, correct?
17.
Yeah, so... I mean, what has it been like between juggling high school and writing music and just kind of getting ready for your future?
Yeah. People always ask me, like, how I go about writing a song and everything, and I think it's just a process of being honest with yourself, and it doesn't really take much for me to sit down and write a song. It's just something that comes to me, and it's never been something I have to really juggle with school. It's like a separate entity, so...
Awesome. Yeah. Well, so, and do you have any plans for after high school? Like, are you going to be continuing music?
Well, right now, music is just plan B for me. Plan A is to go to college, hopefully Syracuse University, study forensic science. Yeah.
Wow, that's a big difference.
Yeah.
How did that come about?
Yeah, I just always have loved, you know, I watch Forensic Files with my parents, like, every night.
I'm just a super nerd
with that stuff, so...
So your songs, what are some of them, what are the main themes of your songs?
Well, the album is called Alive. It's not really just the title of the album, it's more of like an underlying theme throughout the album. I write usually when I'm going through something like either tough or like very exciting, but you know, for the tough times, it's like important to, you know, realize that you're gonna come out alive after everything is said and done. So that was the underlying theme of it.
Really good message. So when anybody listens to your songs or even your new EP, what do you want their takeaway message after listening to be?
I want them to feel something, definitely, and just to take away the fact that, you know, writing is a way of just being honest with yourself, and I hope that I inspire people to do the same thing.
So you are very active with performing and stuff like that. Have you ever performed outside of, like, where have you performed throughout Scranton?
Scranton, Wilkes-Barre area.
When I was down in Nashville, I performed on the streets of Nashville. I met a girl named Lexi down there. She's a recording artist from Georgia. And, you know, she took me around Nashville, showed me around. And
what was that like, kind of meeting other artists while you're recording down there?
Yeah, she's amazing. It was really inspiring to see how, you know, she came from Georgia. She has a number one single in Georgia. She's amazing. You know, showed me the ropes of everything and brought me down and showed me places to perform down there. So
that's really great to have a mentor or somebody who you can talk to, whether it's collaboration possibly in the future or working together. So what are, back to your project for Nashville, can you tell us a little bit about what exactly is happening with that?
Yeah, well right now it's a 6-song EP. It's on, you know, iTunes, Spotify, Amazon Music, all that stuff. I hope to go back down and finish it off as an album if the opportunity ever comes about. But
would you ever see yourself performing live at concerts or anything like that?
Yeah, that's a dream. So we'll see what happens with that.
What was it kind of like, just, did you say he called you up, your producer?
Yeah. Well, so my stepdad, like, yeah, my stepdad and him had known each other for a while. Mm-hmm. And I got in touch with him. I sent him some of my analog recordings from my attic. So, you know, not very professional or polished, but we got in touch and he asked me if I'd ever want to work with him, and it was an obvious yes. So
what has been like your favorite part with all of it?
Definitely being in the studio. Mm-hmm. That doubled as, you know, a musical endeavor and a learning experience too for me.
For some of our audience who may not know, what is the actual sound of some of your music?
I would say it's like an indie folk pop sound. Yeah. Probably not. I'm not really a country fan, but, mm-hmm. you know, Nashville, the music city, like,
right.
I just always wanted to experience that, so I thought it was a great place to go, get my start.
I hope you get to go back, especially, I mean, if you were to go back and kind of finish off, is there anything specific that you would do down there to kind of, like, advance yourself in the music business?
Yeah, well, I've been writing since my last trip there, so I think the songs are progressing, and just the sound and the mechanics of the songs are getting better. So I'd want to work with Jamie and see what would come about with that.
Awesome. We are looking forward to talking with Mollie more about her new album. But before we do, we are going to take a quick break. So stay tuned and we'll be right back.
You've messed up your son's haircut.
Mom?
Do you A, try to fix it?
Like it never happened.
B, work with what you got. Or C, show solidarity.
Thank you, babe.
As a parent, there are no perfect answers. But you don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care will love you just the same.
There are 16 million children struggling with hunger in America. That's 1 in 5 daughters, sons, neighbors, and classmates who don't know where their next meal is coming from. Yet billions of pounds of good food go to waste every year. It's time we do something about it. Feeding America is a nationwide network of food banks that helps provide meals to millions of kids and families in need. Visit feedingamerica.org to help them feed even more. Together, we can solve hunger. Together, we're feeding America.
This is the story of a boy who is very sensitive to lights and sounds. So he built secret hiding places where nothing could get in. The boy didn't like looking people in the eye. It made him feel uncomfortable. One day, he found out he had something called autism. His family got him help. And slowly, he learned how to live with it better.
Early intervention can make a lifetime of difference. Learn the signs at autismspeaks.org.
They said I have troll teeth.
That my voice sounded like a possessed baby doll.
That no one would ever love someone as stupid as me.
That I was fat, ugly,
disgusting.
The effect of bullying is potent.
We will no longer be the silent majority.
Now, when you see online bullying, there's something you can do about it.
We're gonna take action with the eye.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness, and so are you.
Welcome back to the show, everyone. We are joined by songwriter Mollie Edsell. Thank you again for coming on the show.
Of course, thanks for having me.
We are so excited. We're going to talk a little bit more about your album now. So you kind of gave us the basic background, but can you tell us a little more about the overall experience of your album and just what to expect from your listeners?
Yeah. Well, it was an amazing experience. Went down to Nashville for a week in November. It was a beautiful, beautiful weather, beautiful experience for everything. And I think what people can take away from the album is just hopefully inspiration, you know, if people are trying to do the same thing that I was doing, you know, being an independent artist, not having a label, I think it's really, it should be an inspiration to people that you can honestly do whatever you need to do, do whatever you want.
So writing music and playing music is different for every musician. Can you tell us a little bit about what makes it for you different?
Yeah, I first started playing regularly gigs at a charity called Marley's Mission, and that was an equine therapy for children who, you know, went through like abuse or anything like that. So I remember the first time I played there, and there was a girl who was really inspired by me, and that just made me want to keep doing it over and over again. That was the moment that I knew.
So it's six songs on your EP album. Mm-hmm. So what is kind of the message with all those songs? You kind of said that the title drifts through it all. So can you just explain a little bit more about it?
Yeah. Well, I wrote most of these songs, you know, when I was going through something, you know, tough or whatever. And the song Alive is actually the embodiment of the whole entire EP. I wrote that song about a breakup. And I just thought it was a really cool concept that, you know, maybe like the love was over and like it was dying, whatever, but I was coming out alive, and there were parts of me that were coming alive that, you know, I didn't know before, so.
Sounds relatable for some of our audience, or maybe myself, yeah. I'm just kidding. But what are some of your other favorite songs from your album?
I love Haunting. I love that. You know, I was just sitting around in my room, just playing guitar one day. I came up with a riff and it turned into a song.
Awesome. Yeah.
So that was awesome. And then, you know, Sand, that seems to be a favorite among like all my friends. So that's special to me too.
What kind of drives you forward with writing music? Some people get so stuck after writing an album. So what kind of continues to drive you forward and keeps inspiring you?
Well, you know, I think it's always changing. There's never two songs that are the same. There's never two feelings in a song that are the same. So it's just always changing. I feel like that's so exciting to me. So I just always want to keep doing it.
Sounds like growing over time from one song to another, or
exactly.
Maybe future EPs. Can you tell us a little bit more about the process that you go through when you're writing songs?
You know, it's always different. Sometimes it's music first, sometimes it's lyrics first. Sometimes I'm in the shower and I just decide that sounds great and I'm going to put in a song. It happens differently every time. Mm-hmm. It's always changing.
So your album was released back in March, and it reached iTunes Best EP Albums. What was that like seeing it?
I did not believe it at first at all. My grandma called me and told me that it was number 6 on the alternative EP chart, and that was unbelievable. So,
how has this kind of built you up with just like from going from not having anything at all, just being this normal girl, writing songs, playing guitar, to now having your own album and being listed on iTunes?
Yeah.
Like, how does that feel?
It definitely gave me, you know, more of a drive to do it. And it's a great, you know, builder of confidence that I can go out and do this now and people will listen, you know? It's awesome.
And what do you think about for the future? Are you working on anything new for any new songs for a future EP?
Yeah, I have. I've written two or three new songs since I came back, and I'm really excited to hopefully record them with Jamie again one day.
So now that you have this, what is your next step? Are you going back and writing more songs? Are you continuing just taking a break and really focusing on performing the album that you have?
Yeah, I'm definitely gonna, you know, go perform, get the album out there, have more people listen to it. But, you know, music is just plan B for me right now. Plan A is just to go to college and do all that fun stuff.
How do you kind of tie everything together with your life between school, at wanting to do forensic science, and having music on the side to kind of always rely on?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it's important that, you know, I have that analytical side to me, you know, go to school, do all that stuff. And then there's also the creative side that it's just more of like a way of expressing myself, and I think it all comes together nicely.
Have you ever had a moment where you kind of doubted it almost?
Yeah, there were definitely times because, you know, like being an independent artist, you don't really expect, you don't expect much out of music, but you know, this has really opened my eyes and like made me realize that I want to keep doing this mm-hmm. for a while.
Yeah. So your grandma, you said, noticed the EP being on iTunes. Can you tell us a little bit about your support system and how that helps you move forward as
yeah,
a musician?
Yeah, my family is the best, honestly the best, and my friends too. They're always out supporting me, coming to my live gigs, my live shows. Yeah, it's just, they've been great all the time.
And what would you say to other aspiring musicians who've kind of are kind of in the same position as you almost, you know, not really having anything?
Just go for it. Just go for it. You don't want to live your life regretting that you never did it, so just mm-hmm. go for it.
Really good message. Besides messages, what about any features, albums coming out? I mean, you just released it last month, basically.
Yeah.
So are you already writing new songs and anything?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. There's definitely more to come in the future.
Anything you're looking forward to mostly?
I wrote a song called Sugar. Mm. That is it's on SoundCloud
sweet.
Right now. It's on SoundCloud if anybody wants to listen to it. That's definitely my favorite I've written so far, so I'm excited to see when I bring it to the studio what'll happen.
Awesome. Well, we're excited, and we are running out of time, but don't worry, because Mollie will be performing two of her songs from her album Alive right after this, so stay tuned right here on Late Night Marywood.
They said I have troll teeth.
That my voice sounded like a possessed baby doll.
That no one would ever love someone as stupid as me.
That I was fat, ugly.
Disgusting.
The effect of bullying is potent.
We will no longer be the silent majority.
Now, when you see online bullying, there's something you can do about it.
We're gonna take action with the eye.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness, and so are you.
So who's going to do what?
I'll pack the dead batteries.
Great.
I'll only put what I don't need into a duffel bag.
Perfect. That's totally unhelpful.
No problem.
Meanwhile, I will try to comfort everyone by speaking in a calm voice.
And who is going to handle supplies?
I can forget to do a list for us.
Thanks, pal.
We couldn't be any less prepared. I'm proud of you guys.
Talk to your kids about who to call, where to meet, what to pack. Visit ready.gov/kids for tips and information.
Alvin and the Chipmunks want to remind you, bacteria can hide in food and make you ill.
Wow.
But you can keep bacteria from ruining your day with four simple steps. Clean.
I'm waiting for the rinse cycle.
Separate. Cook.
Fire in the hole.
And chill.
We chipmunks are notoriously tidy.
Check your steps. The road trip to food safety starts at foodsafety.gov.
There's one thing you can never have sex without.
It's not something you buy.
Or something you take.
In fact, there's only one way to get it.
It has to be given to you, freely.
It's consent.
Because sex without it isn't sex.
It's rape. Consent.
If you don't get it, you don't get it. It's on us to stop sexual assault.
Learn how and take the pledge at itsonus.org.
Right, mi cariño. So like I said, everything I learned about cooking, I learned from grandma's empanadas. Shall we go again?
Yep.
Mix beef with the onions with the peppers with the paprika, the garlic with the oregano with the cumin. Got it?
Got it.
Throw on the olives, stir, season, stir again, pour out the flour, roll out the dough, make a circle, drop in a fistful of filling, fold over, press down, and ta-da!
Most parenting is hard to do in just 2 minutes. But 2 minutes twice a day making sure they brush is easier, and it could help save them from a lifetime of tooth pain.
You think getting dumped by text is harsh? Try getting dumped by tennis ball. My ex-owner drove me out to the woods, yelled fetch, and by the time I brought the ball back, he was gone. Yeah, I was pissed. But the folks at the shelter helped me let go of my anger. I learned coping skills, like taking it to the hole. Boom! Now I'm ready to fetch again. But how about I throw and you run and get it?
Thank you for joining us again on Late Night Marywood. We are almost out of time, but before we go, performing Alive, please welcome Mollie Edsell.
Into the messes you made, but if I learned one thing, it was to never degrade. I'm standing straight like a soldier, I'm a true renegade. Now I'm ready to let go, to make my escape. To come alive.
Don't go anywhere because Mollie will be joining us again right after this, so stay tuned.
You think getting dumped by text is harsh? Try getting dumped by tennis ball. My ex-owner drove me out to the woods, yelled fetch, and by the time I brought the ball back, he was gone. Yeah, I was pissed. But the folks at the shelter helped me let go of my anger. I learned coping skills, like taking it to the hole. Boom! Now I'm ready to fetch again. But how about I throw and you run and get it?
Todd's a great guy. I mean, look at him. What a sweetheart. Attaboy. Wait, Todd, what are you doing? How totally selfish and un-Todd-like of you. Come on, Todd. Come on, man.
You're doing great. We're gonna try this again, okay?
Okay.
Wheels, pedals, handlebar, brakes. Sit up straight, keep your weight in the center, keep your eyes on the road, hands on the grips, button the seat. If we feel ourselves falling, what do?
Just keep pedaling.
Good girl. Now remember, it's all about balance and steering. Steer with your hands, steer with your body. Steer into the corners and you stay out of trouble. And the bell's your buddy, so go ahead and ding that. All right, ready? Here we go. Pedal, honey, pedal. Go, you're a bike rider.
Most parenting is hard to do in just 2 minutes. But 2 minutes twice a day making sure they brush is easier, and it could help save them from a lifetime of tooth pain.
performing her original song, Haunting. Please welcome back Mollie Edsell.
Outside and all along the sidewalk, I saw ghosts dance, intertwine their pale green spines. I found it pointless, but who am I to talk? I pretended that they wouldn't one day be crying. I saw past times, you're haunted.
You can buy Mollie's album on iTunes and Google Play and listen to it on Amazon Music as well.
So definitely go check that out. And we want to thank you for joining us on another episode of Late Night Marywood. You could tune in because next week we have Easter break. So tune in on April 24th, same time, same place, right here on Facebook Live or Comcast Channel 21 at 9 p.m.
Catch up on all of our old episodes on YouTube and make sure that you are following us and liking us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, because you don't want to miss any of our behind the scenes.
Yeah, so definitely check those out for any behind the scenes. And enjoy your Easter break, everyone.
And most of all, have a great week, everybody.
Yeah, that was great.
Awesome.
Yeah, so that...